Well, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Bugfest, and of course, we're celebrating the Monarch Butterfly festivities. Bienvenidos a todos. Por favor, estamos muy contentos de introducir este baile folclórico de la región de Michoacán, el baile de las mariposas. This is a typical dance from Michoacán, a state in Mexico, and the kids are going to be representing the dance of the butterflies. They have been practicing, and the unique thing about our dance group is that we are both teachers that would love to promote our Mexican heritage and culture, and we do it by volunteering and going to festivals and promoting it. And some of the children in our group are non-native speakers in the Spanish language, so we are excited that they love to perform with us. And so we're ready to start, and thank you for coming once again. And I passed out some flyers about our dance class and our dance company. It's Baile Folclórico Vicky, and welcome. Thank you from Canada and Mexico, the Mexican consulate that are here. Thank you for coming. And we're getting ready to start in a minute. All right, Ms. Vicky.
Thank you.
Thank you for your patience. We're in the middle of costume change. The last number they did was from the state of Michoacán, where the butterflies are going to be migrating next. So if you watched the movie, they showed it at the Spanish version earlier, and they're going to show the movie again after this performance in English in 3D. So it'll be here in this theater after this performance. So you're welcome to stay and enjoy the movie as well. So you'll know that the dance that they just did is from that place in Mexico, Michoacán, which is a beautiful place, the sanctuary of the butterflies. The next number they're gonna be dancing is from the state of Chiapas. A lot of the beautiful costumes that they wear, the local people, indigenous people, hand make them. So a lot of the things that Miss Vicky brings, she brings from Mexico as well. And the outfits that you just saw, the kids wearing, she makes them. She made the braids, the bows, everything. So everything is handmade by her. So like I said, she's a teacher and passionate about promoting our culture, as I am as well, being a Mexican-American, promoting our heritage, especially at this month, Heritage Month. We are excited that the Mexican Consulate and the Museum of Life and Sciences invited us to participate. So thank you for your patience. The kids were a little bit nervous performing with such a big crowd, but I think they've gotten used to it, being invited to a lot of festivals around Raleigh and the surrounding areas. They're getting the hang of it, so thank you. So they'll be coming up shortly.
Thank you. The Expresiones Culturales Mexico Regional. Please, another hand for this wonderful group. What a great day for unity in North America. Welcome to the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences and to the WREL Theater to Bugfest. You know, this is one of the nation's largest one-day museum festival events. Typically 30,000 people come to Bugfest on this one day each fall. This was postponed from a Saturday during Hurricane Florence, and I am sure I want to say on behalf of all the organization in the museum, all the staff that work so hard on this, that we appreciate all the flexibility of those who wanted to rearrange plans and could rearrange plans to come and join us again today. My name is Emlyn Koster. I'm the director of this museum. And so again, welcome on behalf of the state of North Carolina, Governor Cooper, our secretary, Susie Hamilton, and this museum, which has been around since 1879. And we're very grateful that that we have this chance to bring our mission. The purpose of this museum is to illuminate the natural world and inspire its conservation by asking four questions, which this afternoon's program is so suitable for. The questions we ask as we illuminate the natural world and inspire conservation are: what do we know, how do we know, what's happening now, and how does the public participate? And so to focus on an insect that weighs less than a 20th of an ounce, that travels 3,000 miles, and we didn't know where it went in Mexico until 1976. And we still don't fully understand how these amazing little insects, they're orange and black, flutter their way between a few places in Mexico at high altitude and across the North American continent, across the United States to southern Canada. I am a Canadian, and so I'm pleased in particular to, if we can keep the noise down a little bit and focus on the program. You've got a lot of treats in store, but it's a great pleasure then to have the countries at each end of this monarch butterfly migration bring you their own welcome. And here first is the Consulate General for Mexico here in Raleigh, Remedios Gomez Arnaud, who has had previous postings in Atlanta and in San Diego. Please welcome Remedios Arnaud, the Consul General for Mexico here in Raleigh.
Buenos dias, good morning everyone. We're really excited. First of all, thank you to Emily Koster, the Director of the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences, for hosting this event. And I also want to recognize that my colleague, the Consul General of Canada, she flew from Atlanta to be with us this morning. So thank you for hosting this event. The idea to have this came from a drawing contest that the Mexican government organizes every year that is called This Is My Mexico, and invites children from all over the world to make drawings about different things of the Mexican culture. So last year we invited to make drawings about the monarch butterfly, and we asked the Museum of Natural Sciences if they wanted to exhibit that, and they said immediately that they did want it. So we wanted to bring families in a fun way to discover this amazing flight of the monarch butterflies that, as Emlyn said, that crosses thousands of miles to go through all the three countries, flapping their wings and making this amazing journey. And so we also wanted to bring children closer to natural science. Our goal at the Mexican consulates, along with the chapter of Raleigh of the Global Network of Mexican Professionals Abroad, some of them are here with us today. Please stand up. Thank you for being with us. So we are all interested in bringing children to natural science. And but it's not only the natural beauty of the butterflies that people admire. Let me tell you something that many people are not aware of. that indigenous groups in Mexico consider that this flight is a spiritual one, a supernatural one. Why? Because the monarchs arrived to Michoacán State during the last week of October and the first week of November. That coincides with the Day of the Dead in Mexico, that is November 2nd. So they think, since pre-Columbian times, that the butterflies are the souls of their beloved departed ones. So that's a nice story. And indigenous people like Aztecs call them different ways. For example, Aztecs call them Quetzalpapalotl. That means sacred butterfly. So I hope that you enjoy the film that we will see later and just see the monarch butterfly from different perspectives, the natural, the supernatural. But the one we want to highlight today is that it's an insect that links together Canada, United States, and Mexico. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Remedios. And I wanted to mention that you were appointed to this position by the President of Mexico in 2016, is that correct? And so it's now my pleasure to go to the other end of the migration route. And as you've heard, we are very grateful to have Nadia Theodore, who's the Consulate General of Canada, based in Atlanta, who comes to that appointment under Prime Minister Trudeau, Justin Trudeau of Canada, from a previous appointment in serving in Europe. So please welcome the Consulate General of Canada, Nadia Theodore, please.
Hi, everybody. Bonjour. Buenos dias. It is a pleasure for me to be here today with all of you to celebrate the monarch butterfly. It really was a privilege for me to fly here from Atlanta because I actually spent a year earlier on in my life in Mexico and actually traveled to Michoacán to see the monarch butterflies at the sanctuary that they have there. And so this event is a very special one for me to be able to bring this exhibit here to this wonderful museum. And also to really celebrate the partnership between Canada, Mexico, and the United States. And so I really would like to give my sincerest thanks to the director and my fellow Canadian of the museum for having me, and for my friend and partner here in North Carolina, the Consul General for Mexico, Remedios. Thank you very much for inviting me. I thought I would take my couple of minutes to tell you a little bit about the monarch butterfly and its importance in Canada. Because I think that when people think of the monarch butterfly, they actually don't really know about the connection to Canada. They think about it in terms of a butterfly that obviously makes a transit into Mexico from the United States, but it actually starts in Canada. It's a 4,000 kilometer journey to the wintering sites in the mountain forests of Mexico, but it actually starts its three phases in Canada. So the monarch butterflies travel from southern Canada through the United States and then onwards to Mexico. And then the phase two takes place in the spring when they begin their journey north, and then phase three takes place in the summer, 2 to 3 generations after leaving Mexico, when they begin to arrive back into southern Canada. And so in Canada, the monarchs are numerous only, obviously, in the southern regions of the country where milkweed grows, although de temps en temps, sometimes they venture farther north. Their natural habitat in Canada can be found in Ontario, in Quebec, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and the maritime provinces of Prince Edward Island, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and Newfoundland. Researchers say that the monarch butterflies are able to fly such great distances in North America because they know how to save their energy by riding columns of rising warm air and taking advantage of strong winds to help speed their flight. And in fact, in 2016, the Montreal Insectarium started conducting a scientific research program called Monarch Mission to help save monarch butterflies with experts everywhere in North America. That insectarium also participated in what we call the Fiesta Monarch, which is held in Montreal a few years ago. And that was really the beginning of this collaboration between Mexico, Canada, and the United States to bring the story of the monarch butterfly to more places around our three countries. And so this fruitful relationship is really what has brought us here today. And as Remedio said, and as Emlyn said, it is really an expression of the cooperation between Canada, the United States, and Mexico. We are three countries that really share not only an economic future together, but we really share social relationships, and the relationships that we have are very broad and very deep. And the expression of the butterfly is really a symbol of that broad and deep relationship. And so I thank you all for being here. I encourage you to go out and look at the exhibit that's here right out these doors to your right after you see this wonderful movie. And I would also just like to tell the museum that in honor of this fantastic day that we have today, the Consul General, myself, and my office have dedicated one of our symbols of the monarch butterfly, this drawing that we did for the museum. So thank you very much. Enjoy the film. Enjoy the exhibit.
Thank you very much, Nadia. Now would be a good time to make sure you have 3D glasses. They're available from our staff in the back corner. But before we get to the film, which is an award-winning film on the flight of the butterflies and what we understand about it, we have two other brief parts of the program. And I now have a pleasure of introducing to you Dr. Robert Healy, who is an emeritus professor in the Nicholas School of the Environment at Duke University, a specialist in policy in the environment as it relates, as you can imagine in this story, to what was required and what is required in order to conserve the habitats of the monarch butterfly. Please welcome Emeritus Professor Healy from Duke University.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I've been in the conservation area for a remarkably long time. And I've been privileged to see an amazing number of natural areas and natural phenomena. And I've got to say, easily in my top 10, are two very different things involving the monarch butterfly. One of them was something that happened about 40 years ago. I was in Mexico City. I was working with some Mexican scholars to prepare the first ever State of the Environment report for Mexico. And one of my collaborators, a lawyer named Rodolfo Ogario, said, "Bob, you have to come with me this weekend and see something amazing." I said, "Sure." So we drove 4 hours west of Mexico City, stayed overnight, got up really early, went up in the mountains, walked a long ways, and there on some trees were what looked like dead leaves. And as it got warmer, the sun came up, suddenly these trees came to life. And first there were tens, then hundreds, then thousands of monarchs. And they were all through the air. They were covering us. You had to be careful not to step on them. It was just an amazing sight. The second time was closer to home and very different. About 20 years ago, I was at the beach in North Carolina, just looking out to sea, and I saw a monarch butterfly just not high, not going anywhere, but just going from plant to plant. And then I saw two more going from plant to plant. And over the course of a half hour, I probably saw 50, and there was always only one or two at a time. They were very low. And suddenly it dawned on me that every single one of these 50 was going from my left to my right, from north to south. And what I was seeing was really in a microcosm, this incredible migration. They were waiting, of course, for the air currents to take them all the way to Mexico. And I thought, wow, this is just totally amazing. Now, what I was seeing, of course, was the movement of the monarchs from Canada and the eastern and central United States down to what's a tiny, tiny area in the mountains of the state of Michoacán in central Mexico. Now, one of the things that's remarkable is there was a pretty big spot on that map, but in fact, where they congregate, there's several places, but where the majority of them congregate is an incredibly small place. They're on pine trees called oyamel pines that grow only in Mexico, and it varies from year to year from 5 to 12 acres. And we are talking about something you could drop into downtown Raleigh and have lots of room to spare. Now, that's pretty remarkable. This is the entrance to what is now one of the monarch sanctuaries, and the local people will give you guides, horses, sell you food. They're happy to protect the monarchs. But the monarchs need a particular kind of forest, and you have to look well beyond these 5 to 12 acres. You've got to make sure that they have other places to go in case something happens to where they go right now. Now, Mexico has dedicated a monarch butterfly reserve that actually, in theory, is over 100,000 acres. But most of Mexico's protected areas, including this one, are not on government land like our national parks and national forests. They're land that belong to ejidos. These are small farmers. They grow corn, and up in the higher elevations, they harvest these oyamel pines for pulpwood. And you can see the quality of the land behind this guy. Now, there's a lot of threats to the forest. There's natural threats. There's windstorm, tree diseases and pests, forest fires, and of course, all of this exacerbated in ways that we still don't really understand by climate change. And there's timber cutting and land clearing. And we have to be very sure that we have these very small areas where the monarchs are now, but if something happens to these small areas, the monarchs will go someplace else, but only if they have the proper habitat. This is something from the New York Times, and it compares 1971 to 1999, and even more has happened since then. You can see these areas that were decreed as the monarch reserve have lines around them, and the area within the lines is almost as deforested as the area outside the lines. Now, we have been worried about the monarchs. In the late 1990s, it was estimated there were 1 billion of them. There was a low of, in 2014, of only 56 million. That's not a lot of monarchs to cover the amount of territory they spend in the United States and Canada. But we now think that this was primarily due to weather in Mexico, and they have come back. And the people who study monarchs at the University of Kansas, they believe that despite drought in the Midwest, this will be the best season for migration since 2008. And one of the really positive things is the number of people, citizens, that have been putting these little tags on the monarchs. You can put a tag on a monarch and it's not going to hurt it, a little piece of paper, and when people see them, they can report to Monarch Watch and see, you know, where they're found. But our next challenge is restoring the environment. These ejidos, as I say, they grow corn, they harvest timber. It's very small scale. For the corn in particular, if you grow 5 acres of corn, how do you compete with industrialized agriculture in the Corn Belt in the American Midwest? You really can't. A lot of people are abandoning these farms and moving to cities. And there is a movement, mostly private, to reforest some of this abandoned land. And you can see this is some of the progress, but two things you should look at. One is, look at the size of those little fields, and he's really planted one of those fields. And also look at the size of the trees. These trees are probably 10 years old, but they're not big enough for a monarch to rest on them. That's going to take another 30 or 40 years. This really is a continental challenge. In 2014, there was a meeting in Toluca, Mexico, of the prime ministers of Canada and Mexico, president of the United States, and they identified monarch conservation as a NAFTA priority. But if you look at that picture, none of these people are now leading their countries. The Fish and Wildlife Service has gotten some money to do monarch research and to protect monarch habitat, but is this something that's going to be guaranteed in the long run? So the monarchs are protected, but we have to look well beyond these very, very small places where the monarchs congregate to a much broader landscape. And this landscape is not just in Mexico, it's also in the United States and Canada. So I'd like to introduce Chris Goforth, who is an entomologist and environmental educator at this museum, and she is going to tell us about the biology and ecology of the monarchs.
All right. I'm really excited to be here today to talk to you about monarch butterflies. As you heard, I'm an entomologist. I study insects. I do not study monarchs. I'll just tell you that up front. I study dragonflies and aquatic insects. But monarchs are a really special insect for entomologists because they do some really amazing things. And in particular, I want to focus on how people like you, who may or may not be scientists, have helped us understand this migration the way that we do. And then we'll watch the film right after I'm done. Okay, so you all know what monarchs look like at this point. You know, they're big, beautiful, orange, black, and white butterflies that fly between Canada and Mexico. And there was a question for a long time about where they go. Now, this might not seem like a really big question to ask, but a lot of insect adults die in the winter, and you leave another stage for the next year. And so either eggs or caterpillars or larvae of some sort or pupae are what last into the next season. And so it's really common for the adult butterflies to die in the fall. They've just reached the end of their life, and then the next stage takes on for the next year. But there was one gentleman in Canada, in fact, that was really interested in directional movement that he saw these monarchs making. So he, as a child, was watching watched monarchs a lot and saw that they were tending to go one direction and then would disappear. And so he began to think that these might be a migratory species that they were moving. And so he started asking questions. At the age of 17, he started writing to researchers asking if they thought that this species might be a migratory species. At the time, there wasn't much known about migratory insects, so this was kind of a big deal that this might be a migratory species. And so these two people are Fred and Nora Urquhart. They lived in Toronto, Canada in the early 1900s through about 2006, 2009. The two of them passed away about 10 years ago, but they worked together on monarch migration. Fred was a zoologist at the University of Toronto and was very interested in this monarch question because he'd spent so many years watching the monarchs and wanted to know where they went. Now, these people were doing their research in the mid-1900s, and for those of you in the room that grew up with computers, I'm not sure you understand how hard it was for people to talk to each other before the internet came along. Yeah, they had telephones, but if you wanted to send a piece of paper to someone, you know, you had to put it in the mail, and it took a really long time. And so these, this couple decided they wanted to figure out where these monarchs went in the winter, but that's a really, really hard question when you don't have the ease of communication that we do today. So what they came up with was a tagging system, and we're still using the same kind of system today, where they glued little paper tags onto the wings of the monarchs. Each tag has an individual number and had some information about where to send that tag number if someone found this monarch out in the wild. And so they would glue these tags onto the monarchs and then let them go. And so they relied on people to tell them when they found the monarchs. They started this organization called the Insect Migration Association. It was a very early citizen science project. And so people all over Canada and the US were seeing ads in newspapers, magazines, on TV, in newsletters for different naturalist groups. They put out these advertisements everywhere they could, trying to reach the people that might be seeing these monarchs. Again, just think about how hard that was to do. You had to read a newspaper and see that these researchers in Canada wanted you to look for monarchs. And there were only a couple thousand of these tagged every year. So when you're looking at a couple thousand individuals in a billion monarchs, that's not very many. So this was a really, really hard thing for them to do. But they ended up with several hundred people that belonged to the Insect Migration Association that were looking for these monarch butterflies as they flew south. They published these maps multiple times in the newsletter for the Insect Migration Association. And what you can see is that a lot of them were tagged in Toronto, where the Urquharts lived, and then they traveled down the east coast in various directions. They tended to follow the big rivers, like the Mississippi and the Missouri rivers, and here the coast. And so they were traveling from the north to the south, at least that's what it looked like. And then there is this other population in California that travels from Northern California to Southern California. This one does not go into Mexico, and so that one's a different genetic strain that stays in the U.S., but this one is the one that goes into Mexico, and they were traveling, it looked like at least, from at least Canada down into the southern U.S. So this is the first map that they produced, second, third, fourth. So they're all kind of showing the same thing, that you have these monarchs that are moving from north to south, and you have this other population in California. But the really tricky thing is they weren't really sure where they were going yet, because they weren't stopping in the U.S., they thought, but they didn't have anyone in Mexico that was looking for them yet. So they ended up with 304 tagged monarchs that were reported back to them. That's not a whole lot of monarchs, honestly, out of the billions out there in the world. Now millions, unfortunately, but at the time, billions. And they only got this many tags back. So this woman came along, Catalina Aguado Trail. She and her husband, Ken Bruger, were in Mexico, and they saw an ad by the Urquharts asking for people to look for these monarchs in Mexico. They wanted to know if the monarchs were going to Mexico and needed proof that they were actually moving there. So Catalina was really instrumental in finding where these monarchs went. As you probably know, people in really rural areas tend to like to talk to their own people a little bit more than outsiders sometimes. And so they were traveling around in this Winnebago, and Catalina would talk to the Mexican people in the areas where they thought the monarchs might be going, and in around Michoacán and some other states around that area, asking people where they were seeing these butterflies flying so that they could find where they went. They spent 2 years as citizen scientists, people who were not trained as scientists, collecting data on where these things might go. And they were eventually the ones that found those sanctuaries that exist now in Mexico. So it was a Canadian researcher and a Mexican woman and her American husband who ultimately figured out that these monarchs are going to Mexico, to these few mountain ranges in Mexico, into these Oyamel fir forests. So in 1976, National Geographic featured the butterfly sanctuaries in their magazine, and that was when Fred Urquhart first got to go see the monarch sanctuaries. Now, they still didn't have proof that the monarchs were definitely going from Canada to Mexico at that time. You needed to have a tagged individual to show that those things were actually happening. So the picture here is one that was in that National Geographic issue with Fred holding a tagged monarch. This one was tagged in Michigan in the U.S. and had flown all the way to Mexico. And it was the first time that we had definitive evidence that showed that these animals were actually traveling those thousands of miles between Canada and Mexico. And there's more and more and more evidence that's piled up since. Catalina was on the cover of National Geographic. And so again, we had our Canadian researcher, our Mexican citizen scientist featured in this really amazing article that came out in 1976. All right, let me just tell you, tagging still continues, as you heard from Bob. You can still tag monarchs through Monarch Watch. But I want to tell you just very briefly kind of what we've learned from these tagging programs. So monarchs tend to start out in January in these overwintering sites. This is what an OML fir forest looks like in Mexico. And you have all these butterflies that are hanging out there on the trees. They just sit there because they're cold-blooded animals. They're very cold during the winter, and they can't really move around. But come March, the weather warms up enough that they start getting a little more active. They start moving around a lot more. And so you'll start to see big flights of these butterflies. And eventually, they all kind of get up and start moving back into the U.S. So come about March, they end up making it into Texas. Then the butterflies are going to lay their eggs, and those adults will finally die. And so this next generation, these eggs will hatch, turn into caterpillars. They'll turn into adults eventually, and they will continue flying. So by May, you start to get the butterflies spread out a little bit more. That first generation spreads out a little bit more in the U.S. You'll find them on milkweeds all over the area. Then they lay their eggs and die, and you have another generation that spreads a little further north. So these are some of the ones that start getting back into Canada. And then often you have a third generation as well. These are really short-lived generations. The adults only live a few weeks in these generations. And then in the fall, the late summer, you have a generation that has a genetic switch turned on in their DNA that changes them from a really short-lived species, one that only lives a few weeks as adults, to one that lives about 6 months as adults. And these are the ones that fly from Canada and the U.S. down into Mexico. They're able to live a much, much longer life. And so they fly many, many thousands of miles between these three countries to get back into Mexico. And then you've already seen this, but we're looking at these little black splotches down here. Those are the only places that those monarchs are able to go in Mexico. So very, very small little area. And I just want to finish by telling you that there are three projects that you can do today that will help researchers understand monarchs even better. The first one is Journey North. This one is very, very easy to participate in. You simply report to Journey North when you see adult monarchs. And so if you see them flying around, you tell them. And they have some really great real-time maps that will show you where the migration is has reached, both going southward and going northward. It's called Journey North because they focused on the northward migration first, but now they have maps for both the southward and the northward migration. Monarch Watch is the tagging program, and so you have to buy the tags from Monarch Watch. They run about $10 for 25 little tags, but you can catch monarchs, put the sticker on, you write some really basic information about your butterflies down, and then you let them go. Then in around usually May or June, they're not super fast about getting their data up. You can see both where other people saw your butterflies along the way, and also if your butterfly made it into Mexico or not, because they do a big survey every year in January of the butterflies in Mexico to see how many of them actually made it there. And then the last project I want to tell you about is the Monarch Larva Monitoring Project. This one's looking at monarch reproduction, and you monitor a patch of milkweed and look for monarch eggs and caterpillars and report them to the project. This one takes a lot more time than the other two, but it's a really amazing project. You really get to know the caterpillars, what they do, where they are. It's a really, really great project to participate in if you're interested. All right, and with that, we are going to show the short version of Flight of the Butterflies. There are two versions of this film. One of them features, the longer version features the citizen science, the Urquharts, and their story. This one will not have that component, which is why I wanted to share that story with you. But this is a really amazing film. If you have not seen it yet, it is spectacularly beautiful. It's really well researched. It was funded by the National Science Foundation, and I hope you enjoy it. It's a really, really lovely experience. Thank you.
Just a few closing remarks, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Let me, if we can just turn down the music in the booth, thanks. Let me just emphasize the citizen science opportunity. We're lucky here in the Research Triangle that we have an abundance of programs that you, at any age and stage, from wherever you are, you can climb on to some program. Several were mentioned from the Monarch Butterfly. But the Citizen Science Association, which is bringing its annual conference here to Raleigh, to the Convention Center next March, you can go on their website, Citizen Science Association, find out about that. We're co-hosting that locally with NC State University. And so this area is regarded as the epicenter of citizen science in the world. So there's really no excuse if you'd like to just latch on to one of these programs and help collect data and participate in research. Before I thank our speakers, I would like to just dedicate today's program to Jonathan Barker, the executive producer of this film that we've just seen, who passed away way too early in Toronto. He imagined this film, obtained the funding from the National Science Foundation, and was a close colleague of mine, Jonathan Barker. But in closing then, let me thank my colleague here, Chris Goforth, our colleague from Nicholas School of the Environment at Duke University, Bob Neely, and the Consul General from Mexico, Remedios Arnaud, and the Consul from Atlanta for Canada, Nadia Theodore. Please join me in thanking our speakers and for the day's program, and please enjoy the rest of Bugfest.